silicon carbide can go up to junction temperatures easily of 200 degrees Celsius.
Yeah.
That gives you a whole different dimension of thermal design.
Yeah.
And it gives you that advantage despite the fact of the chip having a relatively small area. Now that's enabled because silicon carbide has a thermal conductivity that's higher than silicon. So despite the fact that your RDS on times area shrinks, right, you still can get the heat out. We have decades and decades of knowledge in device design. That enables us to build a trench MOSFET in silicon carbide that extends on the ability of the material. So you have two things. You have the material, silicon carbide, and then you have the device technology. So anybody can take a piece of silicon carbide and you get these wonderful material properties. It's a wide bandgap material. It's got good thermal conductivity. It has a high breakdown voltage because it's got the wide bandgap and so on. But now what you do with your slab of silicon carbide, this is the secret sauce of the knowledge of a company. This is where you bring in device technology. And here you look at Infineon and we take this decades of silicon device knowledge, IGBT knowledge, and we develop a super best-in-class silicon carbide-based MOSFET based on a trench technology. And now you can get the best-in-class RDS on-times area. At the same time, you got reliability properties because your gate oxide can be made thicker than in planar devices. You have threshold voltages that are more stable. And then we extend on silicon carbide. We don't stop with the MOSFET, but we take it into the next level of device technology. So for the MOSFET, we're moving to the super junction technology. And the super junction technology is well known out of the silicon MOSFET space. Infineon, as a matter of fact, is the founding father of the super junction technology, right? The cool MOS, super famous. And often people think, oh, so why do you need a silicon carbide MOSFET in your car's drive? It's not a fast switching application, right? The narrative among a lot of designers is wide bandgap materials, GaN, SiC, it's for fast switching application. That's also not completely true, right? Because even even when you look at a car's driving profile, what do you usually have? Unless you're a Formula One driver, you're usually in your partial load condition, right? So when you're in your partial load condition, silicon carbide MOSFET really excels over an IGBT, over anything else. Well, because your RDS on does not have a knee voltage like the IGBT that it needs to overcome until it goes on. It goes on. GaN-hemmed silicon carbide MOSFETs, they have a resistive region and they go on from the get-go. Yeah. So your partial load condition is going to be better. And usually driving is partial load. Yeah, stop and go in traffic. And then if you look at the losses, the switching losses, you also gain there, even if you stay at the lower switching frequency. And here the reason is, if you look at, let's say, IGBT-based drives, and again, we have wonderful IGBTs in our portfolio, industry leader. I mean, IGBTs of Infineon have a long heritage, absolute right of existence, but I'm passionate about the wide bandgap because, again, contrast to the misconception that, oh, it's for fast switching, if I look at the slow switching, I'm still gaining because my turn-on losses and my turn-off losses, the waveforms, they look completely different. So in the application, even if I don't change anything, right, just due to the fact that the body diode of the silicon carbide has a low QRR, you get a very good on efficiency, you're already gaining efficiency points, extending the range of your car. We are developing so many exciting things on top of that material, like the JFET. The JFET, and it's funny because a lot of people have been coming at the booth saying, oh, didn't Infineon already once have a JFET? Plan to make a JFET and then you went for the MOSFET. Why are you going for the JFET again? I keep telling them, this is not the same JFET that Infineon planned a decade ago, right? This is a completely new design. And it's for DC type applications. It's for constantly on applications. Yeah? And then people wonder, you know, what is that type of application? Yeah? And I tell them, solid state power distribution. And they're like, so give me an example. And this is, you know, you got solid state circuit breakers. Why are they becoming important? Look at the infrastructural changes that are coming. You got a lot of green energy. They're all DC. Battery backup systems, right? You got your wind energy. Yeah, it's a turning motor, but at the end, it's a DC output. You look at your solar, it's DC. Yeah, a lot of these DC grids, we unnecessarily change them into AC and then back into DC. So why don't we just go straight DC? If you go straight DC, you take your classical breaker, and that all of a sudden, DC fault is very different than AC fault. Yeah, AC fault is really hard to break it mechanically because the DC does not have a zero crossing anymore. Now, if you look at a DC relay for 800 volts, 16 amps, they become quickly expensive. And now we developed the JFET to revolutionize that space, to allow for the digitalization of such an old application. Yeah, circuit breaker is one of them. You got battery disconnects, right? You got megawatt charging in your trucks coming in the future. You want to make sure that that battery turns off fast. And now your pyrofuse might not be fast enough because the time it takes for the pyrofuse to disconnect, right? The current is building up. You got hundreds of kiloamps. You can switch off in a microsecond. That current doesn't even build up. So battery disconnect are going solid state. Also the space you gain in the truck or in the car. You go from a 16, 17 kilogram, 30 centimeter big breaker to a little box. This JFET that we designed intrinsically has been optimized for 3-4 specific application needs because it's a product that was derived from the system. We call it system to product, right? We looked what's happening in these systems and what happens in your circuit breaker. It's on 24 hours, 365 days a year, right? It's constantly conducting current. So it needs to be a device that can constantly conduct current at the lowest possible RDS(on). It needs to be avalanche robust, yeah? Because when you have a disconnect case, you know, then you have a commutation current, you have a lot of inductances, you can have an avalanche situation, yeah? So we need to have avalanche robustness that's more than a MOSFET can deliver. We need a short circuit robustness. And one of the trade-offs of modern wide bandgap-based technology is the current density is so high that you don't have necessarily intrinsic short circuit robustness. Yeah? One of the things Infineon is very proud about is that we have the only short circuit rated, on datasheet rated, MOSFETs on the market. Well, we need to have these excellent thermal performances. We need to be able to go to 200 degrees potentially. We need to have an excellent thermal extraction. And there we are again. We're again at silicon carbide. You get the best blocking voltage, right? Because you need the blocking voltage. DC, 800 volt bus, 600 volt bus, maybe 1000 volt bus in the future, yeah? So you need to have that blocking voltage. You can't do that with silicon easily. You want to have that thermal robustness. You don't get that with silicon. And you wanted that normally on type of property. JFET is a normally on device, and a MOSFET is a normally off device. Yeah. The MOSFET has the gate oxide cell. The JFET has no gate oxide. And again, you have advantages and disadvantages. If you're used to designing with a normally off device, then the MOSFET is your the thing you know. The JFET has all these reliability properties, including the missing gate oxide, which is usually one of those lifetime topics. Yeah. But because of the cell, it's practically a diode on steroids. Yeah. It has the normally on property. Excellent for constantly on applications, because you get the lowest RDS on times area. If we look at wide bandgap technology, no matter if GaN or silicon carbide, on the paper for that single component, you will see a higher price. Yeah, it's the nature of the product. Your raw material is more expensive. Your processes are more expensive. So yes, it results in a more expensive product. But if you look at the different trade-offs, at the end of the day, it enables you completely new savings in your system. You have filters in your system. You have magnetics that are not the filters, but transformers, for instance. You got capacitors in your system. All of this can be redimensioned because you're going to different frequency levels, which are not possible with silicon-based technology. So when you redimension them, typically you can make them smaller because you're going to higher frequencies. In certain applications, because you can have a better RDS on times area, at higher voltages, which you cannot achieve with silicon, you can already think about two things. You might have completely heatsink-free designs, or you might have reduced heatsink designs, which are completely fanless. But exactly on this JFET, right? On this JFET, we showed that if you change the battery disconnect in a car to a wide bandgap full SiC JFET, all of a sudden, the box in which the battery disconnect is becomes completely empty. So we showed the guy, and he looked into it, right? He's the VP of the development. He looks into this, he's like, the box is empty. We're like, yeah, because there was only a corner of it filled. And he immediately looks and he goes, that opens up space for completely different things. You look at data centers, right? You want to have as many GPUs as possible. You want to have those, you know, it's the brain of the whole thing. Now, look at the GPU trend. I mean, today, 1.4 kilowatt per GPU. I always say it's like an induction cooker, right? And you have four of them in one blade in the future. It's like a whole induction cooker. It's enormous. I mean, it's amazing. It's a feat of engineering and technology, but it draws power. And if we look into the future, they're talking about up to 4 kilowatts and more, right? That's crazy. Now, where should that power come from? You want to have an entire rack with power supplies next to it? No, you want to be able to shrink those power supplies, and you want to be able to get 22 kilowatts or 50 kilowatts out of each power supply with the smallest footprint possible. Why bandgap? You go to different switching frequencies, you have higher power blocking voltages, right? You move from the 650 super junction silicon MOSFET to a 1200 volt, 10 milliohm or 2 milliohm silicon carbide MOSFET, right? Completely new game. You really gotta think system. And that's why we're not only passionate about technology and product, we're also passionate about system, because at the end of the day, these products work really well if you think out of the system. And your excellent questions, this is exactly the system thinking we're after. You pay a couple of dollars more on the one device, but you reduce multi-dollar BOM, and at the same time, cost of ownership. We always forget that at the end of the day, there is somebody buying that product and operating it.